And Sanjay, as we talk about the pandemic, we actually just got these numbers I want to read to you out of Florida from Jackson Health System, which I believe is the largest health system in Florida. They've seen a 75% increase in COVID-19 patients in the last 13 days. I know, and we're looking here at the percentage of positive tests in Florida. That's a number we need to watch, as well as hospitalizations. When you hear that 75% increase, what does that tell you?
Well, it tells us that the pace at which this infection is growing over there is obviously much faster than the pace at which testing has been increased. And also that the majority of people, you know, when you're starting to see a very high positivity rate, that means you're not necessarily getting out into the community and actually doing surveillance. You're testing people who are at high risk, who have high concern already. You're finding them. But I think the problem is that means that there's probably a lot more people out there that you're also missing. So, you know, the amount of positivity gives you an idea that, look, this thing may be actually spiraling even faster than we realize. It's a real concern. And obviously, Florida's been a concern for some time since the beginning of this pandemic. One thing about Florida, in addition to those cases rising, I think most people realize is that you probably have a more vulnerable population there as well. People are elderly, people more likely have pre-existing conditions. So this is an area a lot of public health officials are keeping an eye on.
The governor there, though, on that point, Sanjay, and it's interesting, Ron DeSantis is making the case that a lot of these new cases that are being seen in Florida right now are younger people. If you look at the age distribution, he says that they are in the younger population. Now, I think he's saying that to indicate, well, the mortality rate is less among young people, so this won't be as deadly, but it's really a mixed bag.
Yeah, it is a mixed bag. I mean, it's not surprising that you're going to start to see younger people because the state is, you know, largely reopening. I mean, this has been happening since the beginning of May. People that are out and about are probably going to be younger people more so than older or people who are considered vulnerable. But, you know, people who are considered vulnerable still, for the most part, I think are getting the message that they should stay home or certainly stay out of high-risk situations. So this is not surprising. I think the real question then is going to become the mobility then of those younger people. How much are they likely to spread it? And this is still a little bit of a question mark, and it can be an important question to answer as we start to think about, you know, the fall and the winter and even beyond that. We know asymptomatic transmission happens. We know people can transmit this virus even if they don't have symptoms and may even be more contagious right before they develop symptoms. But how is that all going to play out? Look, if we can show this graph of the United States versus the European Union, I think this is such an important point because it did not have to sort of go this way in Florida or the rest of the country in terms of the overall number of cases plateauing seemingly, John, since 2 weeks ago, 20,000 maybe. Now we're back up to 25, 30,000 cases per day. It did not need to go this way. This is what it should have looked like. I mean, people should really remember this image on the screen right now. What the United States has sort of shown, that's our basement, that lowest level of the curve there. That seems like that's our basement. That's what we're comfortable with in this country. 20,000 people per day getting infected, several hundred people dying every day. Look at the EU. That's what it should have been like.
You know, it's remarkable, Sanjay, when you point that out and we see that graph right in front of us, that stark difference between what's happening here and what's happening in the European Union. After we heard Vice President Pence say, you know, in recent days, the media has taken to sounding the alarm bells over a second wave of coronavirus infections. Such panic is overblown, to your point. You know, and as we heard from Dr. Fauci last week, we're still in this first wave. You know, this, as Peter Navarro was saying, yes, the administration is preparing for a second wave. Do you think they're seeing those numbers and panicking?
Yeah, I mean, I think that they're seeing the same numbers that that we're seeing, that the public health officials, I think, are hopefully advising them on, although it's not clear, you know, without the coronavirus task force meetings happening regularly. But the numbers are the numbers, and you can compare them to other places around the world. You know, I think that there was a sense, you hear that, look, that there was an inevitability about this. This is just the way it was going to play out. There's nothing more we could have done. It's like a hurricane coming through or something. But now you know. If you look at Europe, if you look at Asia, in Taiwan, they have 7 people who've died. 7. So, you know, and that's bordering China. And again, you know, I think these comparisons are going to be drawn in perpetuity, but we have a chance to potentially learn from these lessons now. To your question, Erica, I don't think we have the luxury of talking about a second wave right now because we have not gotten out of the first wave, and it's not clear that we will get out of the first wave. Instead of actually having a true sort of ebb and flow, it may just sort of, you know, be micro and macro peaks, you know, for the foreseeable future.
Sanjay, I know you were watching Saturday night when the president said that he at one point asked his advisors to slow down on the testing. It's an outrageous statement. The White House now says he was joking. It's a pretty bad joke. There are 120,000 people dead from coronavirus. You can see that on our screen right now. So I don't know why he would think that was funny. It's also wrong, right, that what we're seeing right now is an increase in positivity in testing in Florida, right, in Arizona, in some of these states. I know you had a pretty visceral reaction when you heard the president say that.
Yeah, it felt like a real travesty, you know, I mean, nearly criminal. This is the one thing that could have changed, I think, one of the main things that could have changed our trajectory in all this. People talk about the fact that we've done some 25 million tests in this country. That's correct, and it is far more than a lot of other countries. The problem is, it's not just the number of tests you do, it's when you do them. We got a really late start, and then the application of testing has been really uneven around the country. There are still lots of places I know where people may fill out questionnaires and say they have symptoms. They have a doctor's referral or recommendation for the testing, and they still can't get a test. 5.5 months now into this, that can't be the way that it is anymore. There's no way we're getting out of this unless we can fix this testing issue. As you know, we talked in by mid-June, there should be 5 million tests per day getting done in this country. These are projections and estimates, obviously. They say by the end of July, it should be 20 million tests per day. That's what we need to do to really be able to find people, isolate them, and break the cycle of transmission. Ultimately, you want to get into a situation where a single individual does not transmit this to more than one individual, even less than that. That's how you start to actually bring that curve way down. We're still at 2 to 3 people are getting infected from every single person. We're never going to get out of this if that's the case.